Hello and welcome to Inside Ophthalmology. I'm Dr. Amrit and today we are beginning our series on corneal dystrophies. This is the very first video in the series and it's designed specially for beginners. We'll start with a quick journey through the history, definition, important exceptions to that definition, and then we'll dive into the classification, both the official IC3D classification and the anatomical classification. But here's the real challenge that most beginners face. They get lost in the names, so many corneal dystrophies, and then there is basically no way to remember which is which. That's exactly what we'll fix in this video. I'll show you simple visual mnemonics that will make these dystrophies stick in your memory, and more importantly, help you instantly identify the layer involved when you see the name. So by the end of this video, you'll be able to classify them confidently, even in an exam setting. So let's get started. The word dystrophy comes from the Greek word dys, meaning wrong or difficult, and trophy means nourishment. So literally, it means faulty nourishment. In ophthalmology, the term was first used by Arthur Gronow back in 1890. He described two patients with nodular corneae. And though interestingly, we now know that they had two different conditions. One had granular dystrophy and the other had macular dystrophy. After Gronow, the term gained popularity through the work of Ernst Fuchs, Wilhelm Uthoff, and later Yoshiharu Yoshida. Over time, our understanding and classification of corneal dystrophies evolved, but the name itself stuck. So what exactly is this corneal dystrophy? Traditionally, it is defined as a group of inherited corneal diseases that are bilateral, symmetrical, slowly progressive in nature, and not related to an environmental or systemic factors. But this is where medicine keeps us humble. There are exceptions. For example, the epithelial basement membrane dystrophy often has no clear hereditary pattern. Similarly, the posterior polymorphous corneal dystrophy can sometimes be unilateral. The macular corneal dystrophy can have systemic biochemical changes, specifically altered serum keratin sulfate levels, giving different phenotypes. So while the definition gives you a framework, the real world always throws curveballs. Now let's move on to classification. The International Committee for Classification of Corneal Dystrophies, the IC3D, uses two key approaches for classification. We have the evidential classification, where dystrophies are grouped based on how strong the scientific proof is, and anatomical classification, where they are grouped by the layer of the cornea affected. In the evidential system, there are four categories: category 1, 2, 3, and category 1 means well-defined diseases with strong clinical, pathological, and genetic evidence. Category 2 means they are well-defined clinically and pathologically, but the genetic confirmation is lacking. Category 3 means that they are well-defined clinically, however, the pathological and genetic, both of the evidences are lacking. And category 4 are rare reports with very minimal evidence. In a moment, we'll dive into the anatomical classification, and this is where the fun is going to really start, because I'll show you how to instantly remember which layer a dystrophy belongs to using the visual mnemonics. Now, here's something interesting. Every corneal dystrophy doesn't just start in category 1 of the IC3D classification. They have to climb their way up there. First, it's spotted clinically, maybe in a patient's slit lamp examination. Then the pathology confirms what exactly is going on once the tissue is available. Next is identification of the chromosome, then the gene is mapped, and later the specific mutations which are involved are identified. And finally, the molecular mechanism behind those mutations is understood. Once all these boxes are ticked, a dystrophy can earn its category 1 status. Now, each dystrophy in the IC3D has its own profile page, just like we have on Insta and Facebook and all the social media platforms. It's like a mini fact sheet summarizing its clinical, pathological, and genetic details. Plus, it also has an OMIM reference number for deeper research. Now, let's shift gears to the anatomical classification. I hope you all remember that cornea has six layers: epithelium, Bowman's layer, stroma, pre-desmmits layer, desmmits membrane, and the endothelium. The IC3D anatomical system classification classifies these dystrophies by which layer is primarily affected. This gives us the epithelial and subepithelial dystrophies, epithelial stromal TGF beta 1 dystrophies. These were previously known as the Bowman's layer dystrophy. At least some of them were called as the Bowman's layer dystrophy. Then we have the stromal dystrophies and the endothelial dystrophy. Now, this is the latest third edition IC3D classification, which came in 2024. The first category is the epithelial subepithelial dystrophies. As the name suggests, these affect the corneal epithelium and the subepithelial level, that's the basement membrane. This group includes six dystrophies. We have the epithelial basement membrane dystrophy, EBMD, the epithelial recurrent erosion dystrophy, subepithelial mucinous corneal dystrophy, Leech epithelial corneal dystrophy, Meesmann's corneal dystrophy, gelatinous drop-like corneal dystrophy. You can see the numbers there, C1, C1, C2. Those are basically the evidential category of the IC3D classification. Now, here's a simple visual story to remember all these six epithelial, subepithelial, corneal dystrophy. Imagine a man named Meesmann. He's walking in a basement which is recurrently flooded with sticky mucin. There's a dog on a leash that chases Meesmann, who slips and falls into a gelatinous drop of jelly. So here, basement tells you about the epithelial basement membrane dystrophy. Recurrent reminds you of epithelial recurrent erosion dystrophy. Mucin can remind you of subepithelial mucinous corneal dystrophy. Leech will remind you the Leech epithelial corneal dystrophy. Meesmann, the man's name, will remind you of Meesmann's corneal dystrophy. And gelatinous drop will remind you of gelatinous drop-like corneal dystrophy. So with this silly little chains of events, you can easily recall the names and order of every dystrophy in this category. Next, let's move on to the epithelial stromal TGF beta 1 dystrophies. This group has five key members, and all of them are linked to mutations in the TGF beta 1 gene. Here's the lineup. We have the Rice-Buckler's corneal dystrophy. I like to pronounce it as Rice-Buckler's, so it sticks better in the mnemonic. Then we have the Thiel-Behnke corneal dystrophy, and for our mnemonic, I'll call it Thiel-Behnke. Then we have lattice corneal dystrophy type 1. Remember, only type 1 is in the group. The type 2 is actually not a true corneal dystrophy, since it's caused by the gel-solin gene mutation and comes with systemic amyloidosis features. And therefore, it's also known as the Mariposa syndrome. Then we have granular corneal dystrophy type 1 and granular corneal dystrophy type 2. The type 2 combines both granular and lattice pattern phenotypes and is also known as the Evelino dystrophy. Now, the Rice-Buckler and the Thiel-Behnke corneal dystrophies were previously known as the Bowman's layer corneal dystrophy. Now, here's the memory hook. Picture a rice farmer from Thailand, and he's building a lattice fence. Next to him are two jars filled with rice granules, one jar for type 1 and one jar for type 2. Now, floating behind him is a glowing DNA double helix you can see labeled with TGF beta 1, reminding you of the genetic link. So if you lock that scene in your mind, you'll never forget the five epithelial stromal TGF beta 1 dystrophies. Here, rice will remind you of the Rice-Buckler corneal dystrophy. Thailand will remind you of Thiel-Behnke corneal dystrophy. Lattice fence will remind you of the lattice dystrophy type 1. And the rice granules in two jars will remind you of two types of granular dystrophies. Next, we move to the proper stromal dystrophies. These affect the stroma itself without primarily involving the epithelium or the endothelium. The key members here are the macular corneal dystrophy, Schneider corneal dystrophy, congenital stromal corneal dystrophy, Fleck corneal dystrophy, posterior amorphous corneal dystrophy, central cloudy dystrophy of Francois, and the pre-desmmits corneal dystrophy. Now, two of these, the central cloudy dystrophy of Francois and the pre-desmmits corneal dystrophy, sit in category 4 of the IC3D classification. That means they are very rare and with limited evidence available. So here's your visual mnemonic. Picture Mac Schneider walking alongside his childhood friend named Storma. As they stroll, they spot a shiny fleck glimmering on the ground. Above them are amorphous clouds drifting lazily across the sky, and it's just before the first light of dawn. So here, Max Schneider reminds you of two dystrophies, MAC, macular corneal dystrophy, and Schneider is Schneider corneal dystrophy. The friend, the childhood friend, Storma, is representing the congenital stromal corneal dystrophy. The shiny fleck reminds you of fleck corneal dystrophy, and amorphous clouds reminds you of posterior amorphous corneal dystrophy, and the clouds reminds you of the central cloudy dystrophy of Francois. The pre-dawn light reminds us of the pre-desmmits corneal dystrophy. So lock in the scene and you will have these stromal dystrophies ready for instant recall. All right. Now finally, we reach the endothelial and desmmits membrane dystrophies. This group involves the deepest layer of the cornea, the endothelium, its basement membrane, and the desmmits membrane. The key players here are the Fuchs endothelial corneal dystrophy, posterior polymorphous corneal dystrophy, congenital hereditary endothelial dystrophy, that is type 1, congenital hereditary dystrophy type 2, that is CHED1 and CHED2, X-link endothelial corneal dystrophy. So here's your visual story. Imagine a shape-shifting fox named Fuchs. While wandering through the vast endothelial city, he meets two twin siblings, CHED1 and CHED2. The twins help the fox safely cross the endothelial city. So here Fuchs represents a Fuchs endothelial corneal dystrophy. Shape-shifting basically reminds you of posterior polymorphous corneal dystrophy. Twins CHED1 and CHED2 remind you of the congenital hereditary endothelial dystrophies type 1 and type 2. Endothelial city, and basically crossing the endothelial city, reminds you of X-linked endothelial corneal dystrophy. Now let's recap. You have learned four vivid visual stories today. Epithelial subepithelial dystrophy with Meshman, Leish, Mucin, Jelly Drop. Epithelial stromal TGF beta 1 dystrophy, where we studied about a rice farmer from Thailand with lattice fence and jars of granules. Stromal dystrophy, where we talked about the Max Schneider and his childhood friend Storma watching a fleck amorphous clouds before dawn. And endothelial and desmmits dystrophies with a shape shifting fox and CHED twins in the endothelial city. Time for a quick test. Which of the following is a stromal corneal dystrophy? So if you know the answer, type your answer in the comments. Now let's do a rapid fire round, 10 seconds each. Number one, Meesmann corneal dystrophy. Which layer is affected? Time's up. The answer is epithelium. It's an epithelial subepithelial corneal dystrophy. Next one, Rees-Buckler corneal dystrophy. Which layer is affected? Time's up. The answer is epithelium stromal dystrophy. The next is Schneider corneal dystrophy. Which layer is affected? All right, time's up. The answer is stromal layer of the cornea. It's a stromal-based corneal dystrophy. Gelatinous drop-like corneal dystrophy, which layer is affected? The answer is epithelial layer. Next question, posterior polymorphous corneal dystrophy. Can you remember shape-shifting fox? Yeah. So the answer is endothelium layer. So that was all for today. I hope you enjoyed this video. Thank you for watching and have a nice day. And please share it with your friends if you found it useful. And do not forget to subscribe to our channel if you haven't done it already. Thank you and have a nice day.